No. Should I ask you a question?
Sure.
What's the OSI model? What's OSI stand for?
Open System Interconnection.
Open System Interconnect. Who created the OSI?
ISO.
And what is ISO stand for?
International
Organization. Accurate. Because the letters don't really match, right? Because it was the acronyms represent some European, you know, the European terminology. So, in any case, let me, you know, most of you already understand, and I keep saying this because it's true, you know, we have this information already in our head. We already understand the concept behind what networking models, such as the OSI model, explain networking models. Let me be specific, because the other day we talked about network models, right? And that's one LAN, PAN, and so on and so forth. But networking models are models that attempt to explain the process that information has to go through before it can be placed on the physical media or the physical part of the network, before it can become zeros and ones on the actual wire itself. It needs to go through a process. So that before we can put information on the physical media, right? This is physical media. This is the actual cabling. Here we have an optical cable. So fiber optics. Yeah. We'll talk more about these cables later on. But what I'm trying to say is that before the information can be put in this cable, this is a patch cable. Cat 5. And this is a cable. The regular cable. It's a coaxial cable. Alright. The information travels through the cables in the form of electricity or in the form of light. Okay? Or variations of light, if I can put it that way. But before the information can be broken down into the binary zeros and ones in the form of electricity or light or microwaves, for that matter, there has to be a process of preparing the information from the point in which it's created on the computer random access memory, per se, or if you want to simplify it even further, before the information can be sent out from the point where you're creating it on your monitor, per se, and you're typing, say, your resume, okay? There is a process. There is a process in which certain things need to happen a certain way, and the information needs to be prepared in a certain way, depending on the type of information, so that when it gets into the wires, the devices or the receivers who receive the information can interpret the information accordingly. So let me give you an analogy, if I can use an analogy. Let's say that you buy a bicycle. I haven't come up with a better one than that, so if anybody can think of a better analogy than this, I welcome any idea. Excuse me. Okay. Okay, so let's say that you buy a bicycle. The bicycle is in Miami, Florida, and you make the order of the bicycle. Now, it happens to be that the factory that creates these bicycles only have boxes that are a certain size. They don't have bigger boxes than that. So they cannot put the entire bicycle in one single box. In order to get the bicycle to you here in San Francisco, what they're gonna do, what the company is gonna do is they're going to receive your order via internet or mail, magazine, phone, or what have you. And in order to get the information to you, or in order to get the bicycle to you, rather, they're going to disassemble the bicycle, okay? So they're going to take the handle off of it, they're going to take the wheels off of it, the chain, the pedals, the seat, the light that's in the back, the light that's in the front, the brake system, everything's going to get taken apart. And each and every component is going to get placed in a different box. Now, at the end of the day, you're going to have, maybe four or five boxes. Let's just say you have four or five boxes. In order to get all those components to you, they're going to need to label each one of those boxes with the return address, so their address, the address of the company who you're buying the bicycle from, and also the address where you live, right? So the each and every box has to be labeled. Right, so your label is gonna say, Roberto Barrera, address 123 Main Street, San Francisco, California 94113, or something like that. Maybe even United States of America. Just so that we have an understanding that those boxes are intended to travel within the country, just in case there is a misunderstanding. But the point that I'm trying to make is that each and every box has to have its sending information, where it's going and where it's coming from. Each and every box will have to have its own, stamps, per se, its own shipping charge. Maybe one box weighs more than the other. Now, let's say that it's late in the afternoon, And the guy who's responsible for sending the boxes out goes out to the back, to the loading area, and he realizes that there is three different trucks and all of them are almost full, so you can't put all the boxes in just one truck. So he's gonna put maybe one of the boxes in one truck and then close that and let it go, and then put two of the boxes in another truck and the rest of the boxes in another truck. Now, These three different trucks are going to different destinations. One of the trucks may go down to the train station, where packages that go that direction get shipped to, Chicago or Georgia, per se. All right? And then the other truck goes to the airport. So some of the boxes are going to be put on a train. Some of the boxes are going to be put, on an airplane. And then the other third truck goes to the truck stop, the loading area. And they load those boxes into an 18-wheeler. Now, the one truck that took the boxes to the train station, that train goes from Miami to Georgia. And then from Georgia, they're going to unload the boxes and put them into another airplane that will fly everything down to San Antonio, Texas, where everything is going to get checked in. At every stop, there's somebody who checks, where this is coming from and where it's going, so that they put it in the right cargo area. And then from San Antonio, Texas, it's going to get another airplane down to Los Angeles, and from there it's going to get placed on an 18-wheeler that will drive it all the way to San Francisco. Down here by 3rd Street, where and then from there, other individuals who actually go into the streets will grab the bags, put it in the little truck, and then figure out exactly, which street address, zip code, and everything, and find the exact block and come and knock on your door. Meanwhile, that's happening, the other boxes, one of them just flew directly from Miami to Chicago, right? And then from there, it took a train from Chicago to, I don't know, to Washington, up here at Washington State. And then from there, he took an airplane down to San Francisco. And then finally made it to his destination. The other bags that was on the 18-wheeler, that one went from Miami to all the way to Texas, and then from there it was on a train to, you know, I don't know, Reno, and then from Reno it was on an 18-wheeler again down to San Francisco, and so on and so forth. So you're at home waiting for this bicycle to arrive, but the boxes are not going to arrive at the same time for an obvious reason. Because the boxes are taking different routes to get to where you're going, to get to where you are. So it may be that you receive some of the boxes today and some of the boxes tomorrow. Or maybe you receive some of the boxes this morning, and then later this afternoon you get the other shipment coming, and even then you haven't received the rest of the boxes. And then tomorrow afternoon you get the rest of the boxes. Now, if the sender was kind enough to label each of the boxes, because there was, how many boxes did we say we had?
Four.
Four, right? So he's gonna label each and every of the boxes 1 of 4, 2 of 4, 3 of 4, and 4 of 4. So that if I get 2 of the boxes, it's gonna, maybe I get box 1 of 4 and box 3 of 4. I know right away, the moment I receive the first box, how many boxes are on its way, right? Because it's box number 1 of a total of 4. So I'm not going to even open the boxes until I know for certain that I have all my components that I need. Because what's the use, right? If I pop the boxes open, what do I have, a handle and a seat? It's not good, right? I will have to wait until I have all of my boxes. That would be the right thing to do. We'll get the right tools. And then once I have all of my boxes, I will pop open the box, and then I will examine the content, right? I will look at the content and then figure out how it goes together, put it together, right? Hopefully they send me some instructions, right? And I'll follow the instructions. I'll make sure that everything is working. Go test drive. Now, do you think that the guy who's delivering the boxes at is going to deliver the box to the house next door or 3 blocks down the street?
If he's lost.
If he's lost, maybe. If he's a new guy, right? He's the new guy. That may happen. A box may get lost. What happens if a box gets lost? What you would do, right? What you would do is, let's say that the sender was kind enough also to put. Some of those return receipts, you know, the ones that you have to sign when you receive the box. Let's say that the sender was kind enough. It's a good company, so they're really concerned about customer service. And let's say that they put, you know, return receipt to each and every one of the boxes, so that if a whole week goes by and they have only received, you know, confirmation of delivery for 3 of the boxes, they're not even going to wait for you to ask for the box that is missing. What the sender is going to do is going to say, you know what, we didn't receive a confirmation of delivery for box number 4. And box number 4 contained this and this and this component. Let's just put those components in another box and let's just resend it and see what happens. Okay? And then let's say that this time the guy finally figured out that the box got lost, got delivered to the wrong place, and it got destroyed or whatever, and you finally got your components, right? You didn't have to make a phone call to the company to say, hey, where is box 404, right? You just waited for the sender to be kind enough to provide with that kind of customer service. But it may be, you know, or not, if it's a different device that you're buying or a different component that you're buying, that they're not even going to worry. They're just going to send it to you. If you got it, good. If you didn't get it, we're too bad. Right? It may be, depending on what it is. So what happens what I'm trying to get to is for you to visualize what happens when the guy or the gal is walking down the street with the box how does that person figure out where that particular box is going? By looking at the labels that were created originally, right? And also notice that by the time things get here to San Francisco, that box is going to have a whole bunch of stamps, right? Mm-hmm. It's going to say when you travel from Miami to Texas, for example, when you got to Texas, they checked it in, and then they put another label on top of that label to say now this box is going from here to LA. So they put another label. When you got to LA, you say, oh yeah, it's supposed to be here. The final destination is San Francisco. Let me remove that sticker, put another one on there. Now it's going from LA to San Francisco. They put a sticker on there. So by the time you get it, there's, you know, it's been labeled and relabeled many times. And this is why a lot of times when you buy something online, nowadays they give you a code that you can go online and you can tell, or right now I order something that's coming from you know, New York, or right now is in LA, for example. Or right now it just got, you can actually go online and it will tell you where your package is. Every time it gets checked in, it gets scanned, it gets put in the computer of where the location is, and you can more or less tell, you know, when you're expecting a package nowadays, when it's gonna get here. So packages don't get lost that easy nowadays. And any questions on that analogy? No? Does that make sense? That's perfectly clear, right? And you know, the thing too is that if you're going to send a package somewhere, you have so many options when you go to the mailroom. They have the blue stickers. I don't even know what they're for, but they got the blue stickers, right? They got the green stickers that are for signature return, right? They have another sticker that you can put on there that you can buy a warranty in case it gets damaged, the you know, whatever you're packaging in there. They have different boxes that you can buy that you can, if you have something that's fragile, for example, you can buy foam, stereo foam, mm-hmm. and then you can wrap it in newspaper, and then you can package it in a stereo foam, and you put it inside one box, and then you put that box inside another box to protect it even further, and then you can label, you know, you can put all kinds of different labels so that the package can, while it's in transit, can be handled in a particular way, for example. Right? If it's fragile, you put a big sticker on there that says fragile, you know, glass, if it's glass, for example, so that when they're handling the package, they don't just throw the package, right? The content is gonna get broken. And then you buy the insurance and that all of that entails that you're buying different stickers for different things. It's almost the same thing that computers have to do when they are sending information from one to another. The information needs to be broken down into fragments. And then each fragment needs to be labeled in a particular manner so that when the information is in transit, every time the information gets to a checkpoint, that checkpoint, whoever is in charge in that checkpoint, can take a look at the label of where it's coming from and where it's going, and then direct the information in that direction. So, you know, if you remember the first day of class, I said that networks have four basic components, right? You have a sender, you have a receiver, you have protocols, which are set of rules that two or more entities use for communication, and then you have media. So before the sender can send the information through the media, it needs to break the information down, it needs to package the information in a particular way, and then it needs to convert it into zeros and ones, put it through the media, through the cable, so that the receiver can receive the zeros and ones, and then the receiver, because of the protocols of communications that we have agreed to, can take that in zeros and ones, the whole row of hundreds or thousands or millions of zeros and ones, and look at the whole information and inspect it, figure out, oh, is this going to me? If not, then let me label it, this is going to LA, this is going somewhere else. So let me figure out which is the best route for this information to go, and then you would relabel it and send it that direction. So if we have an email, for example, and we need to send it to another computer, the email needs to be, you know, broken down all the way to the zeros and ones and then send down the media. And then the receiver over here needs to be able to, needs to have the ability.
Is this natural?
You guys are clowns, man, I tell you. There's always a clown in every class. It's a practical joke, man. This is for Christmas. We'll put them up here or something.
Sure.
All right. So, anyways, the receiver needs to be able to to interpret the data, right, and then reassemble the information based on the labeling system that was created up here. And it also needs to be able to say, you know what, this information is not for me, let me just, you know, throw it away, right? But the point that I'm trying to make is that models, such as the OSI model or the TCP/IP model, attempt to explain the step-by-step process of the breaking down of the information. Or, you know, if we're going to continue to use the analogy, the OSI model attempts to explain what happens when you walk into the mail room and you begin saying, which box am I going to use? And which address is this supposed to go to? And you begin to label things. You're going to find a pen to label things, and then you have to be legible. And then you start thinking, well, which type of return do I want? Do I want a signature required, or do I want just a confirmation of delivery, right? And then you start making decisions on which label you're going to put on that box, and then when you're completely done sending with that box, before you give it to the mail person, you already made all those decisions. You already pretty much made the decisions of what should happen in route for that particular package, you see? So you put the instructions in there, inside the box, on how to put the bicycle together, so that when the person who's buying the bicycle receives, they can pull the manual and then read through the information and put the bicycle together accordingly. Otherwise, it's not gonna work, right? Don't put the front wheel in the back wheel, because it's not gonna work. All right. So, but before I start talking about the details of the model, of the OSI model, I want to establish the difference between an application and an application. Now that you did not hear an echo, I want to establish the difference between an application and an application, because the OSI model basically has 7 layers. You think of the OSI model as a cake. It's a piece of cake, all right? The OSI model is a piece of cake that has 7 layers. And the 7th layer of the OSI model is the layer that provides services for the applications that you operate. So, and it happens to be that the 7th layer of the OSI model is called the application layer. So that's the confusion for many people, including myself, when I started learning about networking on regards to application. Because before you start learning about networking, we have a particular concept of what an application is. So an application, let me establish that an application is a program. An application is a program. An application in the sense in which we understand it, as far as computer fundamentals, an application is a program that is designed to perform a specific task. You should write this down. An application is a program that is designed to perform a specific task. So, for example, Microsoft Word is an application that is designed to perform a specific task. The specific task of Microsoft Word is to produce Word documents. Excel is an application that is designed to perform a specific task, okay? Is Outlook an application?
Yeah.
Yes, it's an application that is designed to perform a specific task. The specific task of Outlook is what?
Email.
To organize emails, right? To organize your calendar, organize tasks, you know, organize contacts. Internet Explorer, is that an application?
Yes.
Yes, that is an application, right? So that you have applications in the sense that applications are programs that are designed to perform a specific task. Another definition for application is productivity software. Productivity software, right? If I say productivity software, I'm referring to applications in the sense that it's an application that will help me accomplish a particular task. So in that sense, that's applications at this level, in the email level per se, right? Because to create an email, I would use Outlook. You see? To create an email, I would use Outlook. So if this is my seventh layer, I'm going to say layer seven. This is my application layer of the OSI model. Okay? What does it pertain to then if it's not the same thing? If it's not the same thing, what does it pertain to? The application layer in layer 7 pertains to networking applications. Networking applications are protocols. What is a protocol? A protocol is a set of rules that two or more entities use for communication. So when we're talking about networking at the application layer, applications have to do with protocols. Protocols that allow applications at the productivity level to interact with lower level protocols or lower level layers of the OSI model, if you will. So I can say that the application layer here provides an interface, and we're going to talk more in detail about what those interfaces are in later chapters, I think in the next couple of weeks or so. But if I can say that the application layer here is provides an interface between the application at the productivity level, such as Outlook, and the networking process, the process of preparing the information to travel down the network. Okay? So let me give you, just to bring it into perspective, an application layer protocol would be SMTP. SMTP is a protocol of communication that email uses to send email out. SMTP stands for Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. Simple Mail Transfer Protocol. You should learn this term, learn that acronym, so that the application layer will provide an application layer protocol for the application at the productivity level so that it can continue to communicate down the layers beneath itself.
So you're saying that the seventh layer is an application that actually is an application that communicates with the Outlook application.
This is not, it's a protocol. It's not an application in the sense that we understand it here, right? Because here is a program. Mm-hmm. The application is a program. Here the application is a protocol. It's a set of rules for communication, right? Which dictate how that particular information is gonna be broken down and other criteria that we're gonna talk about later. I'm just trying to give an example, right, of the difference. And there's a whole line of application layer protocols that we need to be familiar with that I'm not going to discuss today,
Layer 7 is always the
protocol. Layer 7 is a step which describes what happens to the data at that particular level. So, for example, if this is my email, let's say that this is my data. This is my data in the sense that everything that I typed in the email is in here, okay? When the information comes down to this, this is almost like I'm walking into the mail room, okay? And I'm going to figure out which box I'm going to use to package my bicycle components, right? In essence, I'm just preparing, if you will, the information. It's not in transit yet. And depending on what I'm, depending on what type of package I'm sending, I'm going to choose a different protocol at that level. I'm going to use a different box. I may use styrofoam. I may use plastic. I may use newspapers and then different things to protect it. Or I may not. Maybe I'll just wrap it because it doesn't matter if it gets damaged. It's rigid. It's a rigid package. So that this is only a step that I'm just taking my package from being a simple package to now let me put it in a box, basically. All right, let me put it in a box. Let me, because of the type of package that I have, let me put it in this type of particular box. Okay. So if I have an email, if it's a web page, for example, right? If I'm running Internet Explorer up here. Internet Explorer uses a different type of application layer protocol. Does anybody know what that is?
HTTP,
right? So that we wouldn't label the information coming from Internet Explorer with SMTP because it's not email, you see? Once the information comes down here to this step, we're gonna label it with HTTP. HTTP is an application, it's an application layer protocol, right? That needs to be added to that type of information in preparation for the following steps that are coming down as we prepare the package before we send it out.
So basically the application determines which protocol you use.
Right, so whoever, you know, creates the application here, programmers will also need to abide by certain standards, right? Certain rules that have been standardized by organizations such as the ISO, right? So that if you're running a web browser, web browsers have to use HTTP, right? Or if it's a secure connection, then it's gonna use HTTPS, right? Mm-hmm. So in any case, once we bring the information down into this step, so that this application layer of the OSI model explains, right? That a label is going to be added to this data, which indicates what type of data it is and how it is to be handled later down the road. Then we have the presentation layer. This is layer 6. By the way, you need to learn which layer is what without knowing, without having to think of the layer name. So, for example, if I say layer 7, you should know that layer 7 is the application layer. Because as we move forward, I'm just going to say the application layer at some instances, or I may say layer 7 in some other instances. And I'm expecting you to know that the one thing and the other is the exact same thing, right? So if I say presentation layer, you should know that it's the same thing as layer 6. I'm going to expect you to understand, you know, what layer 6 is. If I say layer 6, you know, then we're talking about the presentation layer. So the presentation layer, at the presentation layer, we still have data that is complete, right? The only thing that we added to this data here is the protocol there, and here we're gonna add what format. Let me say it this way, okay? What format that particular data contains. So for example, if it's a picture, for example, we would be concerned with the language of that picture. So, for example, it's a JPEG, right? It's a, you know, what are other formats for pictures?
PNG.
Okay, PNG, if it's a document,
JPS,
DOC, right, or DOCX, or .txt, right? We're also going to encrypt the data over here. We're going to encrypt it. Encryption happens here. So that we're going to create some level of protection at this level. And we are also going to compress it. We're going to make it just a little bit smaller, right? We're going to compress it. So at the layer seven allows for interfacing between applications up there at the productivity level and application layer protocols. At the presentation layer, we are concerned with the formatting of the data. What kind of data is it? Because we need to make sure that we label it so that when it gets to the destination, whoever is taking it apart can understand, oh, this is the type of data it is, so let me route it this direction, okay? We're going to encrypt it for protection, and we're going to compress it. So at layer six, we still have data in here. At layer five, we have session. We still have complete data here. And in the session layer, we're going to establish a connection. Establish a connection with the intended receiver, right? Establishes, maintains, and terminates user's connection. So we establish a connection, we maintain the connection, and then we end the connections. Is that word? What I want to say? Terminates. I want to say terminates. Let me say finish, because this may apply to later terminology, okay? Let me say finish connections. Okay? Finish connections. So in the session layer, it's almost like picking up the phone and making a phone call, all right, to the intended receiver. Are you there? Are you ready to receive information? I know what you're thinking. I'm not going to say anything. All right, so, you know, what's for dinner, right? So, in layer four, this is the transport layer. In the transport layer, we're going to sequencing. Sequencing happens here. So, remember what I said earlier that if you have four boxes, you would label each one of four, two of four, three of four, yes? Mm-hmm. Sequencing is going to happen here because at this stage, we're going to break the information into fragments so that this data right here is going to be broken into little pieces. Let's say that we're going to break it into three. So, Fragmentation happens at the transport layer of the data, and also sequencing, right? So we're going to break the information into fragments, and then at this point we're going to call it fragments, and we're going to sequence. We're going to sequence each one. We're going to label each box with each sequence. So we're going to say this is one of three, this is two of three, and this is three of three, okay? Because they may not get there at the same time, and we want the receiver to know as soon as it receives the first package that how many total packages it should be receiving before it can reassemble the information together and present it to the upper layers. Let's see, also, flow control happens here. Flow control in the sense that we're going to determine here how many of these packages we're going to send one behind the other. And if And if the receiver, if you know, if we had 1,000 packages per se, and if the receiver says, wait, you're coming too fast at me, all right? We're going to use flow control here to slow the communication down, right? We're also going to label the fragments here in regards to what kind of logical port, and I'm going to talk about this later. Let's just write this down. What kind of logical port is going to use for that particular type of information? Error checking happens here. And there's one more thing that's really important. Acknowledgement. And acknowledging, let me delete this. Acknowledgement meaning that, remember what I said earlier, that I'm the receiver and I'm expecting acknowledgement here that you got the information. And if you didn't get the box that I'm expecting you to receive, I'm going to just send it again, right? I'm going to make the decision at this layer on whether I should send box number 3 again because I never got a confirmation. I'm an acknowledgement that you received that particular box, okay? So in this part, let me highlight fragmentation because this is really important. We converted the data from a complete package to broken down pieces or fragments. Let me fix this. I'm going to say logical ports here. And what else was here?
Error.
What was it?
Error checking.
Is that like checksum?
Like checksum. Okay, so, but hentai, we'll talk about that later. We'll talk about the details later. So in layer 3, this is the networking layer, or the network layer. And in here, what we're going to do is that we're going to take the information or the fragments and we're going to convert them into packages. This is where packaging takes place. Packaging takes place at the network layer, and in essence, what is happening here, if we use IP version 4 as an example, remember that computers in a network identify each other by a number of factors, and one of the main factors is it's an IP address. An IP address, without giving you more detail, because we'll break that down later, would look something like this, 192.168.1.3, for example, okay? And in this layer right here, we're going to convert the fragments into packages. So we call them packets. Here at the network layer, they are packets. And in the packaging process, what we're gonna do is we're going to add the destination IP address and the source IP address, all right? So the destination IP address of the computer, and we'll talk more later about IP addressing, and the source. So it's similar to what you were doing with your package, rather. You were writing the address of where it's coming from and where it's going. So destination and source. Notice that now I have 3 packages with data. That and each one of them has been labeled at the transport layer, and now they are being labeled at the network layer with IP addressing, per se, an IP address. Because the devices that transfer the information, that allow for the transfer for the information, need to have this information in order to determine which direction to send the information. It's pretty straightforward, right? It's pretty straightforward. We'll talk later about addressing.
Are addresses here too?
And that's the next step, right? That's the next step. So that in layer number 2, layer 2 is the data link. Layer. In the data link layer, we're going to convert the packets into frames. This is framing. training takes place at the data link layer. Okay? So that we're going to take these packets of information together with all the information that has been added to it in previous steps, and we're going to add the MAC address, destination and source, to each one of the packets. So each packet is going to be labeled with the destination and source of the device where it is now and where it's going next, the next device over. Okay? This is what framing is all about. So here they are fragments at the transport layer, here they are packets, and here they are frames. We are framing. If I am framing a packet, I am adding the MAC address. The MAC address is a unique identifier. It's a unique identifier of a network interface card. All right, a MAC address is a unique identifier which identifies the physical address of each and every one of these devices. And arguably so, of course, each and every network interface card in the world has a unique MAC address. And a MAC address may look something like this. It may look something like this. 3B, 7C, 9F, 7F, 3791. What kind of numbers are these? What numbering system am I using?
Hexadecimal.
It's a hexadecimal numbering system because hexadecimal numbering system, as I explained in my previous lessons, uses numbers and letters, right? So that at this level we're using octets, right? We're using octets, numbers that represent, you know, a particular address. In this stage of data link layer, of the process of labeling the information, we use hexadecimal numbers. A MAC address is always going to be represented by a hexadecimal number. And a MAC address, usually the first three sets of digits identify the manufacturer of the device. So the first three sets of digits of a MAC address identify who the maker is. So for example, this one over here was made by 3Com. And the MAC address of this device is, let me see, it should be on here somewhere. I'm gonna say it's 001058. 001058. That's the first three groups. And then the other group, the other three sets of numbers, is the unique identifier. Is the unique ID of this particular car that was made by that particular company. So this is the manufacturer, and this is the unique identifier. A MAC address identifies the physical address of the network interface card that particular computer is using, or that particular networking device is using to interact with the network. And it is here at the data link layer where we label the packets, or we frame the packets with that kind of information. The data link layer, it's not worth saying, has two sub-layers. The data link layer has two sub-layers. Anybody know what that is? What those layers are?
LLC.
And what else?
LMAC.
LLC, logical link control. So let me do this right here. LLC at the top level, and MAC at the lower level. All
right.
LLC. Logical link control. Let me write that down here. Logical link control. That's what LLC stands for. MAC stands for
media
access.
Access
what?
Control.
Control.
Control. LLC stands for Logical Link Control. MAC stands for Media Access Control. And in this particular layer, this is where the interaction, you know, begins of the real meat of turning things into actual numbers is going to begin right here, because the logical link control portion of my MAC, of my data link layer, is the one that allows the data link layer to interact with the upper layers. And my MAC sublayer of my data link layer allows me to interact with the lower layer, which is layer one. Layer one is my physical layer. This is where we convert the information to zeros and ones. Electricity. So that they can travel through the network to its intended destination. All right.
Can you explain again how you order that? You convert what?
So it is at the physical layer that the frames become zeros and ones. It is at the physical. So I can say then that the network interface card, Brandon, is what kind of device?
LLC.
It's a physical layer device because this is where the electricity is coming out.
Sorry.
Right? But it also operates at the data link layer because this is where the framing is taking place, right? We have to label the information with the MAC address. Alright, so there's sort of like physical and logical thing happening right here, right? Because now this is my, where's my cage? So this is my physical layer, is the actual physical component of networking. At the physical layer is where we acknowledge the physical components of networking, right? So that this is my network interface card, and my zeros and ones are traveling in the form of electricity through the cable. So if I say that I have a problem in the physical layer, that may mean that I have a cable that's corrupt, or that needs replacing. Or there are devices that are physical layer devices. A network interface card is a perfect example, right?
One question, sir.
Yes.
LLC, is that the logical link control? Is that the communication that is used to communicate with the different layers?
You know, a certain level of sequencing happens here, as well as here, with the logical link control, sort of how many packages am I sending? So this is the logical link control, how many have I sent, right? A certain level of sequencing is taking place there. So, and it's interacting at the logical level, right? So I can think of logical link control is how you think, right? Logical is how you think. Physical is how you behave. We can put it that way, right? The same thing with software and hardware. Logical is the way you think. And then that software, what's your thoughts, right? Your ideas, your desires. And then the hardware is your body parts, right? And then your behavior. So logical link control allows the data link layer the ability to connect at the logical level with the higher level layers. We'll expand on that later.
I just wanted to go over framing once again. Like how is it defined?
Framing is in the framing aspect is when we is the act of adding the source and destination MAC address to the packets. Okay. Right. So we take the packets and now we're gonna frame them. We're gonna put them in a frame, basically as in a drawing, and we're gonna, you know, label it the destination MAC address and the source MAC address of that particular data so that it can go from here to the next physical device. Remember that MAC is the physical address. It's the physical address of the network interface card. So you need to remember the seven layers of the OSI model. You need to remember the seven layers of the OSI model. From layer 7 to layer 1, and from layer 1 to layer 7. Let me give you perhaps an easy way to remember it. If you can remember, let me erase this. Hopefully, I didn't throw anybody off. If you can remember this phrase right here, all people seem to need data processing. All people seem to need data processing. If I can remember that phrase, then I can remember that this letter stands for application, presentation, session, transport, network, data link, and physical layer.
It's a better one.
Hold on. Is that a better one?
Yeah.
Let me give you another one. Please do not throw sausage pizza away.
That one seems weird.
I'll make the first one.
Please do not throw sausage pizza away. Physical, data link, network, transport, session, presentation, and application. If I can remember those two phrases, and I can sit down at the test table, and I remember. You remember.
How about whenever you saw you waffles?
What?
Whenever you saw you waffles.
I don't know any other ones than those two. These are the ones I use. So the book, I think, has another one, something about lawyers. What is it? No, you can't find it? Okay. So we still got a few minutes. So let me give you more information, and I will elaborate more in detail as we move forward on the significance as to why I'm saying what I'm saying, right? But let me tell you that in networking we have devices known as hubs. We have devices known as switches, routers. So let me outline really quick at least those three devices and at which layer of the OSI model they operate. And then I will expand on that on our next lesson, I guess. So, device that operates at layer 1 will be a hub. So let me write this down here. So hubs operate at layer 1, all right? Layer 2 devices, switches. A switch operates in layer 2. Layer 3 devices, routers. Okay? Layer 3 devices, routers. And or layer 3 switches and or firewalls, but I'm going to expand on that later. I don't want to confuse everybody. All right. A hub may also be referred to as a repeater. A repeater. We have switches that are layer 3 switches. They're smart switches that can also operate at layer 3, but for educational purposes, and so not to confuse you, for now, let me establish in this class that hubs operate at layer 1, switches operate at layer 2, and routers operate at layer 3, okay? And if you can remember that when we expand on this theory or on this idea, then hopefully it will make more sense to you, okay? Questions or comments?
You found the other one?
Yeah, it's on page 45. Programmers dare not throw salty pretzels away.
Only a programmer would
remember.
I'm more of a food type, so please do not throw sausage pizza away. And I'm good. All right.